Good evening and welcome to the WDSU News Hot Seat. I'm Norman Robinson. It's been a history-making week for the Southern Baptist Convention. The nation's largest Protestant denomination took its biggest step yet toward resolving its troubled racial past. WDSU anchor LaTanya Norton explains.
It's a historic day right here at the Morial Convention Center in New Orleans. For the first time in its 166-year history, the Southern Baptist Convention elects its first African-American president, and a New Orleans minister is the face of change.
It is my privilege to declare Fred Luter the new president of the Southern Baptist Convention.
It was Tuesday afternoon around 3 o'clock when history was made. Overcome with emotion, Pastor Fred Luter of Franklin Avenue Baptist Church in Gentilly crushed racial barriers by becoming the first African-American president of the predominantly white 16-million-member Southern Baptist Convention.
To God be the glory.
Luter ran unopposed and was nominated by local pastor David Crosby.
He is a man of integrity, with a loving family, and an unblemished, untarnished reputation.
It's as momentous as it was when Obama was elected president.
A historic move for the 95% white denomination, formed in 1845 as a result of slavery.
Those things are behind us, and we're pressing forward to do what Christ has asked us to do.
Today, the former street preacher from the Lower Ninth Ward pastors a congregation of nearly 5,000, many of whom were present along with Luter's family to watch history unfold.
Pastor Luter is the greatest pastor I ever had. I've had many pastors in the past. He's people friendly.
He was a street witness minister. And to say he has come this far, now the whole entire world will know that what has taken place here in his hometown, New Orleans, Louisiana. It means the world to us, but God is good.
And Pastor Luter's tenure begins after the benediction of the two-day meeting, which is set for Wednesday at 5:55. On your side, LaTanya Norton, WDSU News.
Thank you, LaTanya. Of course, that would be Wednesday past, so Pastor Fred Luter is now officially in charge, and he's here tonight to talk about his historic milestone and his plans for the future. Let me congratulate you first.
Thank you, Norman. It is an honor to be here with you, my brother.
No, I'm excited. Very few interviews excite me. This is one that I'm definitely excited about. This is a historic occasion. What message does your election as the first African-American president of the Southern Baptist Convention send to the rest of the country?
Well, first, I think the message sends is that this is not the same old Southern Baptist Convention that was started back as a result of slavery. That we cannot do anything about that. That's part of our past. It's well known now. It's been well documented. There was a time that no blacks, African Americans, were even welcome in this convention, much less in the churches. So I think it would say to America and to the world that this is not the same convention, that this convention now is open for all ethnic groups, red, white, yellow, black, and white, and particularly to African Americans. And we're open to everyone, and I'm Exhibit A to let people know that.
There you go. What does this election mean to you personally?
To me personally, it says to me that God has given me a lot of favor. You know, I grew up in the Lower Ninth Ward, the city of New Orleans, and started pastoring Franklin Avenue with 50 members in attendance, about 65 on row. And now to see that God has allowed me to be elevated to be over the largest denomination in the country, it's really humbling. I'm still pinching myself on, Norman, to just believe that this has happened. But I look at it as the favor of God. I've been faithful to God. I've been faithful to my wife, faithful to my family, faithful to my church. And God say, I'm going to reward your faithfulness.
Very good. What role is the church obligated to Dr. Luter to perform in attempting to resolve the violence that's seemingly decimating segments of our society?
I think it's a critical role. I think the thing that the church needs to do, first of all, is challenge the parents in the home. The church can't do it by itself. Discipline, morals, responsibility, respect for authority, all that starts in the home. And so I believe the church needs to say to parents, to single parents, to individuals, whether it's Grandma Medea, those who are raising kids, that listen, you may not know all the things you need to do or have all the tools that you have, but the church want to be a partner with you, that we have the people, we have the expertise, we have the finances, we have everything that would help you to raise your sons and daughters and grandsons and granddaughters to hopefully challenge them to be more respectful of people, be more respectful of authority. Because I've always believed, Norman, that our young boys could never be what they've never seen. If they've never seen a father in the home, if they've never seen a dad in the home, if they've never seen a dad respecting the law, they could never be what they've never seen. So it starts with the home, but I believe the church has an awesome responsibility to help those home, those parents at the home fulfill that responsibility.
How do clergy like yourself project that message? I know a lot of people who say, well, when people go to church now, they don't hear messages about moral obligation, mm-hmm. about community responsibility, pulling your pants up, being respectful of authority and your elders. How do you walk that line without alienating people?
In my opinion, it's how you say it. You know, you can be very direct, but you can do it in love. You can do it respectful. You can do it as not looking down on folk and demeaning folk and say, you better do this, you better do that. Every sermon I preach, I tell people, I preach to me first. And when I include things that people need to do, I say us, I say we. I never point down the finger. And it lets people know, particularly, and I share my testimony where I came from. Mom and dad were divorced when I was 6 years old. Grew up in the lower ninth ward, tough times. But I let them know, I haven't always been this way. I haven't always been the husband I am or the father that I am. I haven't always been the man that I am. I let them know where I came from. And they can see that if God can do it in his life, then God can do it in my life too. So I think it's how you say it. You got to say it in love, but you also got to use it as a testimony to say, listen, you can do this because other people have done it before you.
Now, when you look at where African Americans have come since arriving here as slaves,
yes, sir.
Now to 2012, a lot of progress has been made. And now you say this is the best of times for African Americans, mm-hmm. and also the worst of times.
Yes.
How do you see elevating the African Americans who have yet to experience the best of times?
That's one of the things that when I look at what's happening in society today, particularly with our younger folk and with the crime and things like that, you know, when I grew up, you know, we didn't have security in the school, we didn't have police all around, we didn't have a monitors where you had to come through things. This is the best of time for us in America, but also the most difficult time for those young people, because we're living in a society that, unfortunately, as a result of crime and the killings and things like that, we're forced to live in a society where you have to deal with the police, you have to deal with the justice system. And so again, I think the challenge goes back to the home, and then now that we in the church and now involved in the schools. We can't do this by ourselves. No man is an island, no man stands alone. I tell people, even the Lone Ranger had Tonto. So we gotta work together, and until we work together as the home, as the church, as the school, as society, that's the only way we're going to be able to put it off. And it's not going to be just one church or one denomination or one priest. It's going to be all of us coming together and realizing we can pull this thing off if we let go our pride, let go our ego, let go our agenda and say what is best for our community, what's best for our city, but most of all, what's best for our young people.
All right, we have to pause now for a quick break. But when we come back, why did the Southern Baptist Convention condemn same-sex marriage? Don't go far.